Good morning and welcome to this, the 18th meeting of the European and External Relations Committee. Can I make the usual request that mobile devices be switched off or on airplane mode because they interfere with the sound system? We have apologies this morning from our colleague Adam Ingram, and we are going to move straight into agenda item one because, as you can see, we have a very full round table this morning. Can I thank you all for coming along? We've got a very important and detailed topic to discuss today, and it's just amazing to have such a varied group of interests around the table to help us with our deliberations. I'm going to go round the table and ask everybody to introduce themselves, but we have two main topics we want to focus on today. Our time is limited, so we want to sort of hone in on the points. The first would be, how would you welcome EU reform? So that'll give you a wee bit of time to think about that. And second, what EU membership means for you or your organisation. So if we go round the table and introduce ourselves, and then we can start with opening questions. So I'm Christina McKelvey, I'm the convener.
I'm Hans Lamalik, I'm the vice convener.
Gary Clark, Scottish Chambers of Commerce.
Willie Coffey, MSP, Kilmarnock, Northern Valley.
Serafin Pazos, Head of Russell's Office, Convention for Scottish Local Authorities, COSLA.
Roderick Campbell, MSP for North East Fife.
Andy Myles, Advocacy Officer with Scottish Environment Link.
Hi, I'm Ali Cairns. I'm Head of the European Unit for SCVO, which is the Scottish Council for Voluntary Organisations.
I'm Alastair Sim, Director of Universities Scotland.
I'm Derek Elder from the Institution of Engineering and Technology.
Andrew McCornick from NFU Scotland.
Jamie McGregor, MSP Highlands and Islands.
Ross Dougal, Scottish Fishermen's Federation.
Good morning and welcome. It's Anne McTaggart, Glasgow MSP.
And I'm Helen Martin, I'm the Assistant Secretary at the S2C.
Owen Kelly, I'm Chief Executive of Scottish Financial Enterprise. We're the representative body for Scotland's financial services industry.
Thank you very much indeed. And can I thank all of you who provided us with written evidence. Written evidence is always very, very helpful when we have limited time to actually, you know, discuss these things. So we appreciate that greatly. I'm just going to go with the opening question, that if, you know, you wanted to see some reform in the European Union, where would you see that reform and how would it look? So I'm just throwing that out there. The round table, I would hope, would work, you know, through me, obviously, you know, but much more of a sort of a conversational situation. So if you just give me a wee nod or a wee, you know, whatever, and let me know that you want in, I'll make sure everybody gets in to get a say. There you go.
I shall launch in, Madam Chairman, for the sake of somebody starting. But from Environment Link's point of view and the 36 organisations who are our members, we've, in the last few years, had to look at the issue of constitutional reform at Scottish level and now at UK and European levels. And our central request for any form of government, which we are going to have to live with, is that it recognises that it's not just about people and economics. It's also about the space in which we live, the land, sea and air which we actually occupy. And within the constitutional framework for whatever state, there should be a fixed understanding that we share the space with other species, other forms of life, and that they require stewardship and protection. This was something that we addressed in the White Paper before the Scottish referendum last year, and it's something that we're addressing as we run up to the EU referendum, trying to make sure that whatever constitutional arrangements we have, written or unwritten or in treaty form, they actually recognise that the Constitution is not just about we, the people of X. It's about we, the people of a space, which needs to be protected, looked after, stewarded, and shared with all the other species.
Any other comments? Derek?
Scotland has a long history of engineering and manufacturing that still continues today, albeit perhaps differently from the way we would have recognised it in the past. The European Union isn't perfect. I think maybe that's one of the reasons why we're having the discussion today, but reforms have to make it better. And I take Andy's point about constitutional issues. They apply as much to what people do as the environment in which they do it. The single market's actually vital for what Scottish engineering companies do, maybe more so than others because it's export-orientated. And skills shortages are frequently mentioned. One of the things that would concern the engineering and manufacturing sector, I guess, would be that if we can't attract the brightest and best to our universities, we can't attract the brightest and best to work in our companies from wherever they come, not necessarily just within the EU, that would actually affect the ability of Scotland to perform well at a global level.
Thank you very much. Andrew.
Yeah, thanks. I'm going to endorse a lot of what Derek has just said. We are very dependent on our export markets. We come in as a common agricultural policy market, and we need a common policy to get our tariff-free products from Scotland across the whole of Europe. And Europe has helped to deliver us access to 50 other partner organisations as well. So we need that. And onto the labour, we actually need access to the labour supply from Europe, free access to this labour. There's a lot of seasonal work that we do in our industry. And you can see the similar things in the hospitality trade and that. So if we were out with Europe at the moment, that would aspect to both ends of this. So we're very strongly seeing that this is things that we need to get sorted out and considered.
If there was to be reform, how would that reform look for the NFU?
We want the common market to work properly. There's two or three things that's happening in there that we can see. We could get access, better access to the market and simplification. Some of the greening stuff that has come forward, we could do with that being delivered back on a sovereignty basis where each country gets control of, instead of being that done from Europe. But it would be still hopefully fitting in with what Andy Myles is hoping for. We can achieve similar things if we all get the same use of it. There's a lot of risk-based stuff that's involved. We'd see it would be better being done as a hazard rather than risk. We've seen neonicotinoids being brought in as a European, and it's got to be a hazard rather than just a risk. We've got to have science behind it to make it work properly. We need to make better use of the science. And there's some of the policies, I'm sorry I'm going on, but there's some of the policies that could do with amalgamated, the likes of the NVZs and the water directives. If we could get that sorted out throughout Europe, it would make it easier and it would help to cut us down on some of the bureaucracy that we are getting in this country. And we need to get that Europe can pull that together and make it into something simpler for us.
Okay, Jamie, do you want to come in?
Yes, I would. I'd just like to ask, I've had a lot of farmers in my region have complained to me this year that their subsidies are much less because of the euro, because the euro has fallen. And in general terms, farmers are getting about somewhere in the region of 20% less, I think, isn't it, than they got last year. Now, is there any way in which that could be reformed?
I think we don't have the pleasure of controlling currency exchange rates as NFU Scotland, and it's basically the way Europe has gone. It's some of the countries, like your Spain, your Portugal, your Greece, that's made the euro worth what the euro is. If we would certainly appreciate a change in the value of currency, but we don't seem to have control over how this is delivered. It's part of the way we are.
Well, to convene, it seems to me that this is a type of unfairness, that this can be controlled by a falling currency. Therefore, our Scottish farmers are having less that they can invest.
Sorry, I wouldn't agree with that, but it basically it's exchange rate that's controlling the value of what we're getting payment. We've still got the same amount of money in euros. The money is determined to us in Pillar 1 through euros. So it's just the exchange rate that's causing the issue. It's not the actual currency. It's how the exchange rate is working, the difference in the value of the pound against the euro.
Right. I take that point. But the fact remains that it's still the farmers who are being disadvantaged.
I will not be the only sector that's being disadvantaged. I would imagine the engineering guys are suffering just as well. A lot of the people that have got an export-based business will be getting the same disadvantages.
So would you say from the farming point of view you would prefer to be in the euro rather than the pound?
No, it still works back as euros.
What are you saying then?
I'm saying it's exchange rate. We get paid in euros. The money that we are delivered from Europe at Pillar 1 payments is based in euros. When it comes across here, it's exchanged into pounds. It's always going to be that value, and it's what the exchange rate is. We've taken a 13% cut in the value of the pound against the euro over the last 2 years. That's where the significant difference is.
Okay, that is a really interesting way to go. I've got Garry to come in next and then Rod.
I agree with an awful lot of what has been said so far. I think from the point of view of our members, businesses of all shapes and sizes across Scotland, looking at the EU, looking at the potential for reform, really I think what we want any tier of government to do is to provide a supportive environment for businesses to grow, to create employment and wealth in Scotland. From the EU's point of view, I think there is a very much an undercurrent from our members that we're picking up in terms of that point about local decision making. Often the EU is seen as being, if anything's happening in the EU, it's, by the time you find out about it, it's too late to do anything about it. And there's a frustration that builds alongside that. So I think we would want to see more transparency. We would probably want to see, I think, more in terms of a local focus of decision making and more emphasis on the role of national governments throughout Europe rather than centralised decision making within Europe. So I think any form of reform within the EU would need to look at that issue, and that's a clear message that's come through from our members.
Okay, thank you. Derek, did you want to come in on that point there?
Yeah, just briefly to say that political decisions can affect exchange rates. Chancellors and their equivalents make decisions that can affect exchange rates, and world markets determine that. It's really beyond the competence of trade bodies, and because engineering was mentioned, professional bodies, to affect that. We can describe how it affects our constituents, but it's really not in our professional competence to be able to influence them. That's over to you as politicians.
Rod.
Could I just broaden out slightly, but following on from some of the comments that Garry Clark was making. The third head of David Cameron's reform agenda is sovereignty. He's calling for an enhanced role for national parliaments by proposing a new arrangement where groups of national parliaments acting together can stop unwanted legislative proposals. And obviously a desire to see the commitment to subsidiarity, whatever that means, fully implemented. So I'd be grateful for the views of the various members of the panel here on those two aspects.
Ross, did you want to come in there?
I wouldn't mind. I mean, we are governed really by the Common Fisheries Policy, which was reformed within the last 2 years. And there was great play made of a move towards regionalisation. Unfortunately, because of the treaties, the EU has exclusive competence for the conservation of marine biological resources. So anything that can be done from the member states is really advisory. The EU will ultimately make the decision, and the big decisions are made there. Fishing in Scotland is pretty well devolved, apart from dealing with Europe, when it's the UK as a member state. And that is the problem we seem to have. We can think, and groups of countries around, say, the North Sea or the Northwest Waters can work together to do things, but ultimately, the EU will make the decision.
How would you see that reformed then?
Very difficult. This is one where it would possibly have to be a treaty change simply because of that clause. I think it's probably fair to say that if a group of member states in a sea basin took something forward, then the EU would find it very difficult to say no if they were all in agreement. But it's still there.
No, a really interesting angle there. Serafin, I think you maybe have something to say in subsidiarity, but you're not having the whole half hour.
No. I promise you, I will be brief. Thank you for that. Yes, indeed. I mean, COSLA's cross-party organisation made up by local authorities. We take a very keen interest on this matter, and we approach from the point of view of what is the role of local government as one of the tiers of governance in Europe. I mean, in reality, we have four tiers of government: the EU, the member state, the devolved administrations, and local government. So it's a pretty complex area. We have worked on that for many years, and And certainly what we are looking forward in terms of the current discussions, not just what's going to come from the next summit, but the discussion going to come after, is to improve some of the arrangements that are currently exist at European level, but also the way it is decisions regarding the US domestically. I don't think it's just exclusively Scottish or UK interest for local government, because we are in close contact with our colleagues from, for instance, the Benelux or Scandinavia, which are in turn discussing these issues with this government. So it's actually much wider than the UK referendum, but the UK referendum discussions are providing an opportunity to consider that. So very briefly, one thing that we see there's need to be improving is clarification of what subsidiarity is. If you look at the treaties, it's contradictory. In one end says it should be the decisions to be taken as far as possible, closest to the people. On the other part of the treaty, it says it's according to the scale and volume of decisions, which tend to favour decisions taken at EU level. So that's something that should be improved, and there are both legal and practical ways to do so. There should be a clarification of powers, because if you look at the list of the treaty, what EU powers with shared competence are very, very general. Because they're very general, everything can be taken at EU, and we are sometimes not having the right discussion about what should be the decision and where it should be taken, because the rules and the treaties itself are ambiguous. In essence, and just to conclude, we should focus on what is the EU providing added value as a transnational or international organization where people pool resources and make partnerships. But equally, at domestic level, there's a discussion to be had in Scotland, in the UK, but also in other countries, in terms of how we understand the European legislation, how we formulate negotiating positions, how to implement that. There's a number of countries that have very well robust arrangements between the national and local level, or within the Member State Parliament and the devolved parliaments, to have enhanced scrutiny, and there are indeed opportunities to revisit also domestic arrangements in that front here in Scotland, as it is the case in other countries. Thank you.
Thank you. Owen, did you want to come in on that point? Yeah.
On that point, I just wanted to respond to your initial question. Okay. So if you want to pursue that, I can come in.
On you go.
So I just from the point of view of financial services, as I say, responding to your initial question about reform in general, our environment is shaped a great deal by the European Union. There's two big things that shape the environment for financial services. One is tax, which is predominantly member state, and one is regulation, which increasingly is EU-wide, partly reflecting the development and importance of the single market for financial services. And I suppose that's number one on our list of areas for reform. There is a sort of nascent single market for financial services in the EU. The investment products created and sold here in Scotland can be distributed throughout the EU to pension funds in Spain and everywhere else. But that's not true for lots of other things, like insurance policies and other things like that. And the reason for that is member state tax frameworks predominantly. So there's more that can be done on the single market. The second area of reform, I think, that we would see as important is in this whole area that people tend to describe as better regulation, which is a terribly vague phrase. But I think already the Juncker Commission has made some quite interesting steps forward on that. They've accepted, I think, the Commission that it's no longer a badge of honour to see how much legislation you can produce. And certainly in our own area, in financial services, they're undertaking a sort of review of the cumulative impact of the many regulatory changes that have come in the last, well, since the financial crisis. I suppose the third area for reform is growth. There is, as many people will know, a really big piece of work going on at the moment to create a capital markets union. Now, that's happening, you know, regardless of any debates we may be having in the UK about reform. I mean, this is a big move. And that has the potential to open up capital markets right across the EU so that, you know, an SME here in Scotland might have access to funds from other parts of the EU much more easily. So the Capital Markets Union has the potential to do some exciting things. The fourth area is we do, I think, and I know this was in the Prime Minister's letter, we do have to tackle the relationship in the economic governance sphere between the Eurozone and the non-Eurozone countries. I mean, that, you know, the UK is not on any foreseeable trajectory going to join the Euro, but we should keep in mind that it's only the UK and Denmark that actually have an opt-out. So I think when the Prime Minister talks about the non-euro countries, it's a smaller group than we might think, because other countries are committed to joining at some future date. So that's really important. And I guess they're the main areas of reform from our point of view.
Before I bring Willie Coffey and Alison, do you want to come in? And I'm going to bring Helen in, so that means everybody's had a response to the initial question.
Thank you, Christina, and thank you for having us today. When on the question of reform, I guess what we would ask is what is the role of civil society in Europe in terms of directly representing EU citizens? Civil society is huge in Europe. There's an extensive array of civil society in all member states and European level organisations that represent civil society at a European level. And in terms of some of the critical questions that the European Union needs to address, civil society has many of the solutions, whether it's from the refugee crisis through to what does our social policy and welfare look in the next 25 to 30 years. So there are lots of solutions that civil society can provide. So our question in terms of reform would be, what is the current role of civil society and how can we improve that? Now, there are many current organised structures that give voice to civil society, but we would like to see that hugely improved in terms of the transparency of the Commission, whether they look at things like a commissioner for civil society, or they look at sort of operational issues and how they operationalise participative democracy within the Commission, within the parliaments, and within the other institutions. So there are some probably pretty clear practical examples that we could give in terms of reform. One of the current structured dialogues, way to give structured dialogue, is through the European Economic Social Committee. We would like to see that have a bit more teeth and its connection to the other political institutions strengthened, so that actually the various groups within the European Economic Social Committee can hold the Commission and others to account more and can allow more participation for civil society through those structures. I think the third area that's certainly more relevant for us here in Scotland is regions and how regions are reflected within the EU. I spend a lot of time working with my colleagues and sister councils throughout Europe, and being a region, you do have a different relationship. Your membership is different. Now, I'm not advocating one thing or another, but I do think that our membership needs to reflect the regions better, so that we have more direct access and a direct relationship with the EU. I'll just make a tiny point on you're mentioning about the exchange rate. That's a big impact on third sector organisations, because of when the exchange rate comes back, you can benefit one way or the other, because it can actually decrease. You've got to set what your cost is at that point. And when the exchange rate comes back, it can be higher or less. So quite often, the money that comes back to NGOs is also so less. But that's just something we've lived with for a very long time. Thanks
very much. Helen, do you want to come in now, and Alistair?
I think really from the trade union point of view, we have two really main areas of concern when it comes to reforming Europe. The first is just simply democratic. I think European institutions seem quite a long way from the people which they serve. They're poorly understood. There's very few opportunities to really engage within the decision-making process. And when you see European citizens really standing up and trying to engage in quite complex issues, like, for example, around TTIP, the opportunities to do that are quite limited. The feedback from the Commission on what they're actually negotiating on behalf of the Union is very limited, and the reform that comes out of the pressure is very limited. So I think from the point of view of an average citizen, it's quite difficult to really involve yourself within European decision-making, and I think if we were going to reinvigorate the Union and have a different Union going forward, it would need to be one that was much more accountable to the citizens of Europe. Equally, the trade union movement really recognises the benefits that have come from Europe over a period of time, and we recognise the benefit of the common market and how that supports business. But for us, really, the question is how that's balanced against the provisions within social Europe. And I think the original design of the union was a very, very good one, and the social Europe emphasis was pretty strong. But in recent years, we've seen that really eroded. We've seen quite right-leaning decisions, and I think from our point of view, we would want to see a reinvigoration of the social Europe elements of the European Union going forward.
Thank you very much. Alistair.
In a sense, I don't really want to say an awful lot about reform, because actually, really, I'm conscious that the university sector is actually getting a lot of benefit, and I think a lot of benefit to society from programmes that are already running. I mean, the European Commission funding through Horizon 2020 and the previous framework programme 7 is the third biggest source of project funding for research. Research is by its nature a cross-border enterprise. Around half of all the published research papers from Scotland are internationally co-authored. So having international structures as part of that complex ecosystem of research makes sense. I'm conscious also that we benefit from being able to help our students to be mobile through the European Union and through the Erasmus programme, where I think we've now got well over 2,000 students a year taking advantage of that to study across Europe. So, and I'm very conscious also on the staff side that mobility is hugely important. I think about 14% of university academic staff are from the EU, a lot are from other countries outside the EU as well. And so the mobility of talent is hugely important. On the reform side, I guess the one thing I'm aware of, but I think it's really, really hard to tackle, is we are extraordinarily proud to welcome over 13,000 students from the EU to Scottish universities. They add an enormous pedagogical richness, and the people who have chosen to come, whether from Ireland or Germany or Greece or wherever, those are our three biggest markets to come to Scotland. You know, they've got to get up and go to have got up and gone. So they really do add to our universities, but obviously, because of the entitlements that EU citizens have and EEA citizens have, the Scottish Government is paying for the tuition costs of these welcome people. I think back in 2011, the SNP manifesto flagged up that it wanted to address that issue, but actually, to be honest, I think the free mobility of people for educational reasons, as much as any other reason, is so hardwired into the EU that I don't think it's an area that to me looks one that is readily reformable.
Okay. Willie Coffey.
In many ways, I think the horse is already bolted in terms of the UK government establishing what its four key priorities for EU reform actually are. And a couple of weeks ago, I got the chance to ask Mr. Liddington who he had consulted about these before the UK government formed those four proposals. So I'm keen to know from this wide cross-section of representatives here, were any of your organisations consulted by the UK government before they decided what these four priorities were? And what do you think about that? And it's great that you're here doing that with us, because we can certainly gather that in and articulate it, but would it also be your intention to write to the UK government with some of these points that you're making too, to express your priorities quite clearly in terms of EU reform to the UK government, because it's they who will be negotiating on your behalf. So I'm curious about whether you were engaged with at all and what you would think about that and what you might want to do about it.
Derek.
I think the short answer is yes. As far as the Institution of Engineering and Technology is concerned, we'd be corresponding with the UK government. However, the timing is not perfect for a referendum on staying in or out of the EU. We don't know what the wording of the particular referendum is going to be. Time is short, and the amount of uncertainty between now and then is only going to increase. So it's a qualified yes. I'm saying that we will take the opportunity to probe the government on its four priorities. But, as I say, a lot of uncertainty around it.
Were you asked to consult on what the four priorities should be?
I'll say a qualified yes to that because I'm not the sole arbiter in that, but if I have anything to do with it, it would be a yes. So a qualified yes to that.
Okay. Andy.
Thank you.
The coalition government at Westminster ran their review of competences in the European Union, which everyone was invited to participate in, and the environment movement certainly made its views felt. It has to be said that, as with any other consultation, there's a question as to how much you're actually listened to when the priorities are set. But I'd like to return to this question of sovereignty and subsidiarity, because we feel that it's fairly vital to this whole discussion. Environmentalists generally believe that decisions taken as close as possible to the individual and local communities are likely to protect the environment better. That the further away geographically that a decision is being taken, particularly on economic matters, the less likely the environment is likely is going to be the focus of that decision and be one of its major elements. So we're strongly in favour, if there is reform of the EU, for the entrenchment of the idea of subsidiarity. But we would point out that it really has to be at all levels. It can't just be at European level. It needs to be something that is brought into international law. We're dealing with global problems like climate change, which cannot be dealt with at local level. So we need agreements internationally on these things. But we need subsidiarity to preserve power and sovereign power, not just in the hands of the nation state, but in the hands of the individual and the local community. It needs to be brought in as a principle that comes in at the UK as well. I mean, there is a certain amount of questioning going on inside environmental minds at the present moment as to whether the claim that one of the four items, subsidiarity and power being brought to national level, is the hugely important thing it is, when you see a government at the same time being in the cheerleader for TTIP. And that's not going to be bringing power back to any local community or individual anytime soon. Far from it. It's going to see the accumulation of power in corporate hands. And in fact, power is going to be moved in the opposite direction of subsidiarity under TTIP. And there seems to be a real contradiction in the position of the UK government. But it also applies here in Scotland. You know, regardless of whether Scotland is independent or part of the UK or part of the EU or whatever, our view is that decision making here should be taken with subsidiarity as well, and that decisions need to be moved back down to local councils, but even beyond local councils, as in the Community Empowerment Bill, to go further, to take decisions down to really local level so that people really consider their environment. Otherwise, you end up with pollution, with waste dumps, with unintended consequences, and a whole series of environmental consequences in the places that people actually live.
Thank you. Serafin.
Just briefly on the same theme, of course. I mean, we subscribe many of the statements made about subsidiarity and local empowerment, but in the question about, in the early question on the negotiation, I mean, I think many of us contributed to the balance of competence review, and I believe Cosla was, from local government across the UK, the one that contribute the most at length to that. So then there has been an element of negotiation at, and is ongoing at very senior level. But at most, what might be agreed in the December summit, or not in March, is just general terms of reference. Then that has to be spelled out in both legislative or political matters, even possibly treaty reform. And that is the opportunity that we are looking forward, together with our partners, to try to narrow down some of the broad principles that hopefully will be agreed among leaders as a starting point in the next few weeks. And that gives an opportunity for clarifying what it is should be done at EU level, and in a way challenge a bit more the assumptions that things are best done at the European level that is currently is the ethos in the European institutions, but equally offers an opportunity here to see how can we best deal with Europe domestically. For instance, what could be the role of the Scottish Parliament in enhanced subsidiarity scrutiny mechanism? For instance, the House of Lords is at the moment piloting a system to make proposals to Europe called the Green Card. Well, there's perhaps a role there for the devolved parliaments, the same in federal parliaments in other member states. Another thing that is important to know that it's very likely that any movement in terms of subsidiarity should be would be based in the Dutch proposals on subsidiarity that were tabled a couple of years ago, to which my opposite numbers from the Netherlands were very much involved in preparing. So that gives an opportunity to perhaps not at, in the previous stage, but in, to involve in detail. I do remember 10 years ago, the Consul and the Scottish Executive drafted a joint statement on EU reform that was sent to the European Convention, which is led to the current Lisbon Treaty. The same way that could be done this time, the same way that perhaps the Scottish Parliament and the UK Parliament could come to a joint approach about what they would like in terms of reform and subsidiarity scrutiny, which I believe will be many opportunities opening. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to move on to the second part of our deliberations today, but I just wanted to make sure that on ideas for reform, if you've got your say on that. And yeah, Andrew.
Right, thank you. I'm going to try and tie a lot in. I've no awareness whatsoever about NFU Scotland being asked about some of the stuff that's been taken forward in this discussion. You can see that by the total lack of any mention anything to do with agriculture. We would certainly have had something to say if we'd been asked, but there's nothing been in there, and it's a very significant part of the Scottish farmers' income is the money coming out of Europe. We need that money in there to keep the jobs supported. But on the subsidiarity, I can see a real place for coming in with a better place on the subsidiarity. If we could get, they're trying to make regulations within Europe that fits arid lands in Greece, with the Paris Basin for growing grain, with the rain and that that's happening in Scotland, you probably haven't noticed the amount we've had this summer. And they're trying to make one regulation fit all. And we're finding that the likes of your three crop rules and that that's designed for the Paris Basin, delivering that in Scotland. We're quite keen to be green with what we're producing. We want to join everything together. But we're 85% less favoured areas. And to try and tie us in with these other regions, subsidiarity would help to produce something a bit better out of that. If we could deliver what Scotland needs for Scotland, or the United Kingdom delivers what United Kingdom needs for the United Kingdom, rather than having that. So subsidiarity is one of the things that we could see as a benefit.
Owen, and then Jamie.
In response to that specific question about the UK government, because our environment, as I was saying, is predominantly shaped by UK frameworks and EU frameworks, we have, you know, frequent discussions with UK ministers, and this always has been part of those discussions. I remember that there's a contrast between an industry like ours and an industry like agriculture, where, you know, it's very much just part of something we discuss with the UK government all the time.
Did you want to come in there?
Well, I just really want to know if anyone thinks that the Prime Minister's reforms go, or what he wants for his reforms, go far enough.
Ah. I'll let you back in a minute, but...
Basically, I'd say I refer to my previous answer.
Okay, well, I've got Hans Allah, who's got a specific question then at the end.
Thank you, Alistair. So, you made reference to a tuition fee, and I'm very keen in that area in particular because of our educational institutions depend a great deal on that. What are your concerns at present, and what would you like to see done to protect that?
I wouldn't want to frame it simply as an issue of concern. I think, as I said at the beginning, I think the fact that we are able to attract students from across the EU, you know, is a testament to the quality of what we're able to provide. And I think they do offer just a huge richness to what we provide. So I don't really identify it first and foremost as a problem issue, but I am conscious that the Scottish Government is picking up the tab. That you know, teaching grant is supporting Scottish domiciled and EU students, and the number of EU students we have is obviously putting a significant pressure on that. I honestly don't know that there is a way around that. I think that is just really part of the consequences of the fact that people do have freedom of movement in the EU. I mean, we were supportive in 2011 when the SNP manifesto said, let's have a look and see if there's some way we can introduce some form of financial contribution from EU students to the costs of coming to university in the EU. And I think there's models that were looked at, for instance, in the Republic of Ireland. Nominally, it's fee-free, but actually students pay, whether it's from Ireland or the rest of the EU, they pay an administration charge each year. But I think, you know, to be fair to the Scottish Government, there was pretty substantial thought and due diligence on how could you construct something that was compatible with the treaties that would enable a financial contribution from EU students. And I think that really the pretty thorough answer that came back was if you're in the EU, or indeed if you're in the wider European Economic Area, it's something that goes so strongly against the treaties that a way forward was not found to enable some financial contribution from EU students. So, you know, I'm not sitting here with a specific proposal for reform, because I think actually a lot of work was done on that and it didn't come up with an implementable solution.
Would you think that now that there is an opportunity to renegotiate in certain areas, we should be considering this area as well?
It may be worth further study. As I say, I'm not approaching that with a great sense of optimism, because I think, you know, as I say, not just at EU level, but also if we were to retain membership of the European Economic Area, I still don't think it gets you out of that that particular issue.
I think Jamie makes a point, are we going far enough, or are we asking for enough? This may be an area of work that we could consider asking. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Come back on my question. I mean, really, if you don't consult with people about what their wishes and desires are, you get what you've got here. You've basically got four priorities that are about restricting immigration, opting out of more EU integration, cutting red tape, and that's really kind of it. That's the basket of wishes and the four wishes that they have. There's nothing in there about cap reforms. There's nothing in there about a fair price for Scotland's farmers for their milk. There's nothing in there about Scotland's allocation of Pillar 1, Pillar 2 being the lowest in the European Union. I mean, I'm glad that Mr McCornick said what he said there, because if they'd asked the NFU what your priorities were, I'm sure he would have said that. And I'm sure I would have hoped that they might have formed part of the submissions. But so I suppose, convener, the only chance now is to continue that dialogue directly with UK ministers to make sure that your voice is heard. We'll certainly, I'm sure, be doing that through this European committee, but I would encourage you to do the same directly yourself.
Okay. I've actually had meetings with the Secretary of State, David Mundell, pressing some of these issues, but as you'll have noticed, there's nothing on agriculture has appeared anywhere. But we had an on-farm meeting with David Mundell, allegedly giving us access straight to the Cabinet, we thought, but there's no mention of agriculture, and we'd be pretty strong if we were given the opportunity. There's quite a lot, as you say, and you've mentioned and highlighted some of our bigger priorities that we could deal with. But we need that, and we'd like to see some of that being brought in as part of the Minister's renegotiation, Prime Minister's renegotiation, because CAP forms almost 40% of the budget in Europe. We're a very, very important part of what goes on in Europe, and we could do with being part of these renegotiations, if nothing else, to get a point of view across that we're needing across. But thank you for the opportunity to come in back in on that.
Helen?
I think just to follow on from your original question and some of the points that have been made, since we certainly had no opportunity to contribute to what the negotiation priorities should be, and I'm not aware that there was a formal consultation on that. And certainly from the STUC's point of view, but I think also from the TUC's point of view, we're extremely concerned about some of the areas that have been selected. The focus on reducing benefits for migrant workers, I think, is just playing to a right-wing audience rather than actually trying to solve a problem within our economy. And we are concerned as well that in order to solve that problem, you would need need to push down on the rights of our own young workers as well, that that might be the only way in which to actually achieve the ends that the Prime Minister wants to achieve. We're also hugely concerned about the focus on the reduction of workers' rights within the negotiation priorities. And I think the STUC is clear that if this is likely to be, if there are significant changes to that, to the system and to how Social Europe functions and to the UK's access to Social Europe in particular, that that puts us in a difficult position with our members, and it is not guaranteed that we would necessarily continue to support a European project in those terms.
Do you want to come in very quickly, and then or we need to move on to the next topic?
Yeah, very quickly. The question that's really being discussed here is, do the proposed four areas of reform go far enough? Well, for us, to be quite honest, and I think this represents the view of quite a lot of people, we didn't ask for this debate and this referendum at all. It's not whether they go far enough or not. I think that for many of us, there are priorities other than this type of constitutional change. And that, you know, in my own sector, we're dealing with the massive loss of biodiversity, with climate change, with a few issues which we think are kind of important, and it sometimes feels like shuffling the deck chairs when we're actually debating any of these constitutional issues, when we would prefer our politicians not to be squabbling about the rules, but to actually be tackling some of the genuine, serious, horrific issues which we have to face up to.
Anne, do you want to move us on to the implications of...
Thanks, Convener. But I think Helen has just kind of answered, but can I ask even just for Alison to follow that up? It was about the rights of workers, and I'm aware, Helen, that was to you, both yourself and Helen. Helen has just mentioned about the rights of workers. Could I possibly ask yourself?
The rights of workers in
to what extent has the membership of the EU affected the rights of workers in Scotland?
Well, Helen probably more experienced about specific rights of workers, but I think in terms of our membership of the EU,
yes,
in terms of, you know, in legislation around employment and those kind of protections, and obviously equality and human rights legislation has, I guess... They've been fairly key drivers, the European Union has been fairly key drivers of some practices that are to be protected and enhanced and enshrined around equality for lots of vulnerable groups, those that have been marginalised in society and those that have been marginalised from the labour market and participating in their democracies in society. And so there are some very fundamental things that we now take for granted or have taken for granted for a very long time that have been driven by the EU project in its entirety. There is always some great initiatives, and quite often if you listen to a lot of things that are discussed and debated at the European Parliament level, some great innovative conversation, lots of wacky stuff, but that's what democracy is all about. There are some fantastically brilliant ideas that are debated, and they lose their momentum. They lose something in the sort of clunky democratic deficits that sit around it to find their way out into member states. But I think it's not to be, you know, forgotten that it's some of those things that, and particularly around lots of employment rights and protections for, whether it's paternity leave, equality for pay for maternity conditions, all of these things, they have been set by the European Union, not by the UK.
Thanks, Convener.
Okay, so what would be the impact on your organisation if we found ourselves outside the EU? Andrew.
I keep cutting in on this, but having said earlier that nearly 40% of the European budget is going to CAP, I think it would be pretty serious implications for our industries. In 2014, there's £560 million committed to Scotland in support payments for agriculture. Now, that money is directed at agriculture, but it delivers a long way down the chain. We're actually, I would say roughly, each pound that's spent through that is equivalent to £4 to the rural economy because of the way it cascades down through the different businesses, keeping other businesses in the area. There's absolutely nothing has been brought in to say how, if we exited Europe, that money would be replaced. When times are good, it gives us the opportunity to reinvest in our business and build them up for strong. When times are bad, it's keeping us in business, and that's the position we're in now. So we need to see, if there is a talk of exit, we need to see what is it is that's going to come into place. And that was part of my comments, but we've never been consulted. This has got to be highlighted, because that could result in, I would say, land abandonment in more remote and more difficult and harder places, because it just not be worth these people there. And if that happens, we're going to lose communities. It's the downstream effects of how this money is used. So the implications would be absolutely huge.
Okay. Andy?
Yeah, it's a very, very difficult question from an environmental point of view, what would happen if we left. In many respects, though, it's you've got to ask what would happen if we never joined. And the chances are that some of the very beneficial European legislation, such as the Birds Directive and the Habitats Directive, quite a few of the directives on matters of pollution, might or might not have gone into UK or Scottish law. On the other hand, the UK could have been better. I would remind people that, for instance, the Birds Directive and the Habitats Directive largely follow from the Wildlife and the Countryside Act passed by Westminster in 1981 under a Conservative government. And it seems odd that you should prefer one piece of legislation to another, particularly as if we left, as members have referred to, we might well be members of the EEA. And if you look at the countries of Europe that have implemented European law best, you'll find that the best performer is in fact not a member of the EU, it's Norway. And so if we left, would it make a great deal of difference to our legal situation with regard to environmental protection or the actual practice that is going on the ground? It might. But it might not. Would it be better or worse for the environment? It might or it might not. It might allow us, for instance, the opportunity to make a lot more sense of the impact of fishing and farming with regard to the environment, and we might be able to sit down and work out much better situations. We might, on the other hand, sit down and find ourselves in the situation where for the environmental position, it got a lot worse. You know, we none of us have a crystal ball as to what's actually happening, going to happen, one way or the other. And I come back to this point that in many respects, this debate is a distraction from the real issues.
Okay, Owen.
Answer, as others have hinted, because we don't know what the terms of the relationship between the UK, if it did vote to leave, and the EU would be, and that's in the nature of these kind of processes. You vote to leave, and then you begin what a two-year period, I think, under the Lisbon Treaty. And during that two-year period, you negotiate the terms of the relationship for the future. Pretty ambitious to get all that done in a couple of years, but maybe it's achievable. So it's very difficult to know. And you know, as I think, you know, in last year's referendum, it's important to focus on what you can know rather than make assumptions about what might or might not be negotiated. And I suppose a couple of quick observations. One is that for an industry like ours, it's currently very difficult to generalise about what companies might or might not do in response to a vote to leave the EU, because it will all depend on where their customers are. For some companies in our membership, all of their customers are outside the UK, for example. So big issues for them would be how will it be to be outside the EU but still trying to serve customers within the EU? Facts you can know about that are that you will have to do something to ensure that you're complying with EU regulatory requirements if you want to provide, say, insurance into the large EU market. One of the things we've learned from talking to our counterparts in Switzerland is that for an industry like ours, and I suspect, you know, there'll be others in the same boat, if anyone thinks that by leaving the EU you can sort of think less about it, the opposite is the case. Switzerland has to spend an awful lot of time tracking every single piece of legislation in the EU because it wants to be part of that single market. So the idea that you can kind of step away from it and sort of, you know, we won't have to worry about it so much is just completely wrong. And I suppose, you know, final, again, slightly obvious point is that as part of a very large trading bloc, we, as part of the EU, I mean, TTIP I know is a controversial example, but in general terms, if you believe it's a good idea to have a trusted and respected world trade framework, in the EU, you're part of one of the big players. Outside the EU, who knows?
Alastair.
I mean, I would echo what previous speakers have said about it all depends on what the successor regime is, but I would say there's an awful lot in what we currently get out of the European Union that it would be that would really present a substantial risk if we lost that. I mean, I think I've talked about the free movement of talent. I think that's really important. I mean, we are internationally connected organisations. Universities only work by having the best talent within them. And equally, I've talked about research being a cross-border enterprise, and I think structures through Horizon 2020, such as Marie Curie initiatives to help researchers cross borders and develop their research careers, are all part of that cross-fertilisation of ideas that comes by being truly international. And likewise, being in the European Union as generators of intellectual property gives you the capacity to make sure that that intellectual property is protected across the whole EU when you generate it and patented it. So, you know, there are really important benefits there that I think it would take some difficulty to reconstruct in a successor regime, and I think particularly as outward-focused international institutions, we really are conscious of the value of being part of international structures.
Thank you. Derek.
Thank you. At the expense of joining the echo chamber, as it seems, I would have to emphasise that the uncertainty and disruption that would, I think, result for the engineering and technology sector if the UK were not in the EU. That's not to say, and some people have made cases for and against indirectly, that's not to say that it wouldn't be a good thing, but uncertainty, disruption. Outside the EU, would Scotland be as attractive a place to work? And labour mobility has been mentioned, very important to the engineering sector. And I would include research and studying in that, Alistair. But also, would UK firms wish to stay in the UK if it were outside the EU? Because, as has been mentioned, you can't ignore it just because you're outside it. Switzerland, Norway, they have to take cognizance of European Union regulation. We would not be part of a global trading bloc, and that's also been mentioned. TTIP's come up. What opportunity would the UK and indeed Scotland have to influence negotiations over such a global trading partnership? Thank you.
Jamie.
Thank you. I think one of the best things, as an MSP for Highlands and Islands region, one of the things that has been the best part about the EU was the structural funding we got when we were Objective 1 status, and which built a great many causeways and bridges and linked up a lot of things. And but of course that structural funding tends to go more to the emerging countries now rather than to Scotland. The question I've got is really more about the single market now, and I'd sort of put this to the Chamber of Commerce particularly. I mean, I know how important. I mean, and this is not just the Chamber of Commerce. I mean, I think Scottish Financial Enterprise, the NFU, the Scottish Fishermen's Federation, all of you, really. How important is access to the single market?
Happy to do so. I mean, I was going to make a couple of points, but that fits in very, very well with that. I think overall, when we did some research amongst our membership across Scotland earlier this year, on the issue of the referendum and the implications of that. When we asked businesses at that time, we asked them around about sort of end of August sort of time, so it's a few months old now, but we found that almost three quarters of businesses said that they would be minded to vote to remain within the EU at that time, and around about 13% said that they'd be minded to vote to leave. When we drilled down into that and looked at the potential benefits and threats from an exit from the EU, we found that, you know, a large number of businesses thought they wouldn't be affected either way. But where threats and benefits were identified, then the threats substantially outweighed the perceived benefits if the UK was to come out of the EU. And principal among that was trading. So any business who is exporting, any business who is importing, around about a third of all businesses that we surveyed told us that they perceived negative impacts from coming out of the EU in terms of their export strategy or their import strategy. And about 40% of businesses told us that there were threats to their overall growth strategy. I think, interestingly, to come back on some of the points that have been made from the university sector and the engineering sector, we also found that almost, or certainly over, one in five businesses told us that there was a threat to their recruitment strategy. So that tells us a great deal, and certainly when we speak to educational institutions in our membership, you know, they're very concerned, even at the perception that the fact we are having a referendum on our future membership of the EU could have in terms of being able to attract students to what are world-class institutions in Scotland. And of course, as businesses, we draw hugely from that, and we'd like to draw more, particularly from an international background, from what our educational institutions can provide. So I think there's certainly a wide range of areas there, including but not restricted to the European, or the single European market, where clearly we export almost £13 billion of goods and services each year at the moment. There's a whole wide range of areas where there are perceived threats, and given that there is an unknown, as you know, everyone has said so far, I think we ought to take those threats seriously.
Ross, I think the Scottish Fishermen's Federation has had quite a difficult relationship with the EU over the years, so maybe you can give us a different perspective.
I think I don't want to bring up ancient history, but I will. if you go back to the 1970s, I think it's probably accepted that the fishing industry in the UK was sold down the river in order to join the EU. And if we came out of the EU, the theory obviously is, since the most of the fishing resources are in what would be Scottish stroke UK waters, you'd get a bigger share of what was there. However, you would have to then have negotiations with all the other countries. At the moment, in the North Sea, for instance, the talks are going on at the moment. There is an annual EU-Norway talk about straddling stocks in the North Sea. If we came out, then there would be a tri-party discussion. You would have to renegotiate with all the other countries that fish in what are currently EU waters that become UK waters. I would think that it would be disingenuous to think that any UK stroke Scottish government would not continue to pay attention to what ICES, the International Council for the Exploration of the Seas, who provide all the stock advice. They would still listen to what that was. So it wouldn't be a free for all. You would still be constrained. So on top of that, a lot of the species that the Scots fleet especially catch are exported into the Eurozone. So there are implications there. There's lots of big questions that would have to be answered. I would like to go back to the money that comes into farming and in terms of fishing. I mean, we benefit under the new scheme, which is going to be European Maritime and Fisheries Fund. And the UK allocation is going to be somewhere in the region of 243 billion euros. And Scotland's going to get about 107, 108 million euros out of that. There's been great play made, especially in Scotland, that, oh, this doesn't reflect the size of the Scottish fishing industry. Well, as has already been said, these are convergence funds. It's not a case of how big is your industry, it's how poor a country are you. So that's the basis in which these made. The only negotiated bit of it is the split between within the UK. Is it too simplistic to say that since the UK is a net contributor to the EU, that if you came out of the EU, all the funds that weren't going to the EU could replace what goes to the farmers, the fishing, or would the UK Treasury just hoover it up?
Alison, I think, did you want to come in at that point?
Yeah, just on the implications of a vote to leave. In terms of the third sector in Scotland, we don't really know what all the implications are. We're just at the early stages, initial stages of conversations with the sector on, you know, raising awareness of the debate and getting them to think about this, and we're kind of launching that a bit more in earnest at our gathering in February, get some greater conversations about what are all the implications for everybody and get people to think about it and you know, raise the questions and things that maybe we haven't thought about so far. But in terms of the European Union is it's much more than a peace project or a free trade area for civil society. Civil society has a sort of fundamental desire, and there are benefits from, you know, closer collaboration with the rest of civil society across Europe. Our broad interests in sort of social issues, containing market forces, you know, stronger welfare policies, you know, make us ideologically compatible, politically and ideologically. Consequently, we often agree on sort of broad policy areas, and we operate within very similar institutional contexts throughout Europe. It's surprising how much similar things are. So we have a strong desire for us to collaborate and to understand and to try and address solutions that face human beings, people in society, in our communities. So it's a much greater thing than just this free trade area. What we do know in terms of the implications for leaving the EU now are some things around structural funding and European funding. There's been less and less money coming to the third sector in Scotland through structural funds. But there's also no guarantee that if that money would come back to the third sector. There are some policy areas that we have quite a strong input into around employability and the environment, poverty, gender equality, and human rights at a European level. We would have to address that through the UK constitutional institutional frameworks. There is no guarantee that we would have the same participation, we'd have the same voice or same influence, and we certainly wouldn't have the same collective collaboration and understanding, because our problems are local, but the solutions are global, and we have to reach out. And whatever constitutional or institutional environment allows that to reach out, for us it's about people participating and to participating in the decisions that affect them. And in many ways they do that through organised structures at a community level, which are, we essentially call civil society, whether it's through their community groups, whether it's through larger organisations. And, you know, without straying into questions around representation and representative democracies, if you have big organisations that say, I don't know, there's a big platform called Dementia Europe that has all the dementia organisations across Europe, and they're working really hard at a European level to really address some things around dementia and the services for people that are affected by dementia throughout the whole of the European Union, because it's a big issue for us as a society, as globally going forward. Dementia is just one area. But civil society is working collectively on that big policy area. Now, they represent directly the interests of people suffering from the whole spectrum of dementia, right through to those working in it, to carers and families. Now, who represents somebody's interests better that's suffering from dementia? That platform, or the current sort of political structures, or the current political environment. So for us, it's about how civil society participates in the democratic processes that are there. So the implications of us not being there are not fully visible to us until they're not there.
Very much, Andrew.
Ross has got me excited. £5.1 billion in 2014 is what Scotland's food and drink was production, and it's been exceeded. We're doing that, so we're exports. That 73% of the United Kingdom's export market in food and drink goes to Europe. But the point about the funding, there's absolutely nothing has been mentioned anywhere about what would happen to the equivalent agricultural money, which would be the equivalent fisheries money in Europe, from the UK government. And they've never shown an awful lot of enthusiasm. DEFRA has never shown a lot of enthusiasm from other than the market returns. And if you look at where agriculture is this year, which is far worse than it's been for a long time, we're in a mess and the market is not delivering. I'll give you some examples of the levels of payments. Beef, the support payment in beef industry is 42% of the output, which is equivalent to 200% of a beef farmer's income. On the sheep sector, 34% of the output is 240% of the income. And in the dairy, it's 9%. This is in last year's figures. 9% of output is 50% of income. Dairy will be a far, far different story. But coming right back to what was mentioned about Lisbon, we put it in our submission about the Lisbon agreement there. In EU Lisbon Treaty, Article 50 states that any member state withdrawing from the European Union shall not participate in discussions of the European Council or Council or in the decisions concerning it. I don't think we'd be allowed to even discuss how we exit. We'd be thrown out, and the decisions would be made beyond it. And there's nothing's going to be guaranteeing us what the tariffs are going to be to trade with that 73% United Kingdom's export market. There's nothing in there. We don't know how it's going to do it. And there's also the implications of other countries importing into the United Kingdom, Scotland. We would lose the strength that we've gained from using Europe as a negotiating body. We'd be a poorer and weaker negotiator. And that would probably result in other products coming in that would make our market even more difficult.
Serafin.
Thank you, Chair. I am in the peculiar position that the whole purpose of my job is to get myself out of a job. That means to arrive in a place that most EU decisions don't directly affect local government. Reality, as I'm going to explain, is a bit more nuanced and has already been evoked. It is, on the one hand, when we have higher standards in Scotland than we have in Europe, we have a contradiction here. For instance, yesterday was tabled a new package on waste targets. The Scottish legislation and programmes are actually more ambitious. So what we end up having is to re-engineer the domestic one with the EU level, just to make sure they closely align, because one thing is the target, the other is actually how to deliver them. Of course, if there were no EU law applicable to councils, there would be perhaps easier arrangements to do shared services, buying local provisions in tendering, which are now very much restricted, or, of course, a looser state aid. However, at the same time, as I say, the reality is more nuanced. I mean, next door to my own office in Brussels are my Norwegian Icelandic colleagues. And as I was mentioned, they are there, even if they are not members of the EU, because a lot of the legislation coming from Europe still affects their local governments. And actually, like I say, I mean, the best experts in procurement in Europe are actually my Norwegian colleagues next door, because they, as they are not part of the decision-making process, they have to be paying a lot of attention to what's going on. And they carry, by the way, excellent study on that, the same for environmental impact assessment. So I think that safe for not having any relationship with the EU at all, I mean, if there is any relationship with the EU, local government, it appears, will continue to be affected. On the issue of EU funds, as just mentioned, I mean, I think it has been highlighted in previous reviews in this committee and elsewhere that the added value of EU funds, not just structural funds, but many of the other funds, is they have the element of multi-annual programming. So you know well beyond the scope of a comprehensive spending review what is going to be the spending. But I think it's more important is the idea of priorities. There's a number of priorities that are agreed at EU level that are openly discussed and do basically sets you the vision. In that respect, it's interesting that if you look at the latest Scottish economic strategy, it's very much done in symbiosis with the EU 2020 strategy, which is the EU level. So in a way, it helped influence the EU thinking, but at the same time, the EU thinking was helping influence domestic policy. And that's an interesting symbiotic relationship. So, as I say, most likely local government will continue to be affected. Our position to influence that will be obviously difficult. So before getting into any of that, I think we have to use the next few months to ensure there is a proper fundamental review about decisions are taking at the European level so that
We can basically make an informed choice in terms of what is going to be impacting our sectors, in our case, in local government. Thank you.
Another dimension. So, is there any other questions or anything? Any of my colleagues around the table got any burning questions that they want to? Is there any other aspects that we haven't touched on this morning that you would like to bring up, Alison?
The opportunities for being part of the European Union that the third sector have been involved in and potentially could be involved in more, and whether that is restricted or prohibited if we're an EEA member or not, or whatever place we are, is yet to be clear. But there are lots of opportunities that have arisen over the past few years for the third sector to collaborate, whether it's accessing structural funding, whether it's accessing the direct European money through what is now Horizon, and there's lots of others, you know, Europe for Citizens money and they're all transnational funding, so they compel you to work in partnership across countries. Now, these are fantastic opportunities, not least for learning and sharing, but also for, you know, exporting good practice and things that happen within Scotland's third sector. And I, you know, we'd like to see a lot more of that. There are decidedly opportunities. We've got quite a few third sector organisations that are involved in, I suppose, business relationships in terms of trading and owning, sharing of buildings and all sorts of things, collaboration over around jobs and civil society recruitment websites and things like that. So we're not clear on the implications to any of that side of things with not being part of the EU. And our concern, I suppose, is that the debate will be dominated by trade, free trade, will be dominated by immigration, and some of the questions that our sector might get to, and possibly later in the day, because they're firefighting, they're not thinking enough about it, and we'll want to try and help them to do that, is that it will be quite late in the day, and debate will be dominated by some of these things. So there is lots of opportunities, and we've had lots of opportunities as a sector within the current EU, and have concern about the debate and what questions are asked and what listening goes on.
Thanks. Helen, just on the back of that, something that crossed my mind coming from a trade union background myself, and realising what the social union part of the EU has created with the Working Time Directive and certain rights within your workplace not to be discriminated against, you know, equal pay, rights to maternity, paternity leave, the rights to a pension for women. You know, there's many, many aspects of that I find, you know, that are very fundamental to good governance within a society, that if, you know, the workers are treated well, you get better productivity there for business, and it's growing circle. But what would you think the STUC's reaction would be to a withdrawal from the EU and a withdrawal from all of that? And I give you that question in the background of what we've seen thus far and the trade union bill and the impact that would have.
I think therein lies the crux of the matter, really, because I think it's fair to say that at present we don't have policy on our position with regards to leaving the EU or not. At present, we are in favour of the European Union, but we recognise that there are areas that need reformed. And a lot of what drives the things that we like about the European Union are exactly all of the things that you've just mentioned. You know, the Working Time Directive is a very, very good example of fantastic legislation that came to Europe. Until that legislation was passed in the UK, the UK workers did not have a right to take time off. And I think, you know, it is a testament to how poor our terms and conditions can be in this country without the drive from Europe for protection. The difficulty comes when we start to analyse what's happening at European level at present and the direction of travel at present, and the fact that collective bargaining arrangements in Belgium, for example, are being dismantled, and the Lisbon Treaty is used as the catalyst for doing that. The fact that we've had poor judgments from the European Court of Justice that mean that European workers can enter the UK, work in the UK and be paid lower rates than UK workers, effectively undercutting collective bargaining arrangements. Like, that is another example of how things can be driven down by Europe as well as pushed up. And I think the question then becomes about what is the offer for the UK going forward? Because, yes, we have to think about what we can negotiate with our own government, but we also have to think about what our government is insulating us from as well. Because it might be that Europe continues to have quite good legislation, but if we don't get access to it here in the UK, then that doesn't necessarily benefit us very well. And if we are also at the same time facing privatisation of our public services because of different decisions being made at the EU level, then that in some ways can make the situation worse. So, I mean, there is no easy answer here. There isn't. And it puts the STUC in quite a difficult position because we recognise all the things that business has said about how much this benefits our economy, and obviously we have an interest in that as well. But we need that economy to work for people, and we need people to be able to have effect on the decisions that are made in their lives as well. And if that procedure doesn't work and doesn't function, then we've got a serious question mark about how this union can really keep going in the longer term.
Thanks very much, Andy.
Just to inform the committee that the environment movement has been discussing the question of Europe, because we have to, it's on the political agenda. And like colleagues around the table, we haven't really, you know, fundamentally put our positions down on paper yet. But I can report two things that might be of interest. The first is that yesterday I was in Birmingham discussing, amongst other things, the European referendum with colleagues from our sister links in Belfast, Cardiff and London. And it is likely that they will take the approach that Scottish Environment Link developed during last year's referendum, which is to say, this is the kind of country we want to live in. This is the kind of Europe, Scotland, UK that we want to live in. And how is your constitutional option going to best deliver our aspirations, so that we will be challenging the in or out campaigns as to what effect they will be having on our aspirations? And I think that should be ready for spring, early summer next year. But the other thing is to say that over the last 7 years, I've represented Scottish Environment Link fairly regularly over in Brussels at the European Environment Bureau, which is the kind of link for the whole of Europe, both EU and non-EU Europe. And it's been a brilliant experience to go and share with colleagues from across the continent the things that they have done where they've succeeded and the things which they've done where they've not succeeded, to share things where they've really made a difference to the environment and things where they've had real problems with industry or government or whatever. And I've drawn ideas from back across Europe which have made a difference here in Scotland, I hope. Similarly, I've been able to take a lot of our Scottish experiences over and share them with my colleagues across Europe. Those things are enormously helpful to civic society, and I echo a lot of what Alison has been saying here, and a lot of what Helen has been saying in terms of social Europe as well. If we left the EU, we'd have to reconstruct the ways of gaining those benefits of sharing experiences across this continent, one way or the other.
Thank you. We've got a few minutes for sort of any other comments. And Derek.
Thanks very much, Convener. I'd just like to do a sort of closing statement like Andy, and I hope it's relevant to other people around the table. The IET has no stated view on EU membership. It's important to say that. Whether it reaches one or not, time will tell. But I don't think I can overemphasise the importance of labour mobility in the European Union. In the last couple of years, I've worked with Portuguese, Spanish, Greek and German engineers here in Scotland. They're here for a reason. There's push and pull factors in that. But my own son works in Spain as an IT engineer. Whether that would be possible in a different EU arrangement for the UK, I simply don't know. The EU can seem overly bureaucratic, and the European Parliament often seems not as powerful as the Commission, and the relationship with the Council of Ministers is complex. But the single market is a very good thing. I think many of us would agree with that. In relation to services, which affects me as a professional engineer, it's underdeveloped. There's no doubt about that. EU reform is needed, but leaving is a very, very different thing from reform. So, thank you.
Okay, is there any other comments or final statements? Now's your chance. No. Well, we're continuing with this inquiry. We have a number of roundtables over the next few weeks. And we'll take, you know, no doubt this whole question forward to the dissolution of this Parliament, which will be in March the next year. But in the meantime, can I thank you for your evidence this morning? Can I thank you for your written evidence? And should you go away and think, should I said that? Or should have developed that argument? Please don't hesitate to get back in touch with us and let us know what your thoughts are. If your organisations are getting involved in anything that you think maybe we can contribute to or learn from, could you please let us know about that as well? Because we know that there's many things bubbling up. You know, there's seminars and, you know, discussion forums bubbling up, and it would be quite keen to maybe get some insight into that too. But just on behalf of the committee, thank you all very, very much. I think we've had a very good discussion this morning, a very diverse discussion, but really, you know, it comes down to a few quite simple things that affect us all, and I think you've managed to articulate that very well this morning, so thank you very much indeed. I'm going to do a brief recess to allow our witnesses to leave their seats. So, I suspend. Okay, welcome back to the European and External Relations Committee. Moving on to agenda item two this morning, which is our Brussels Bulletin. You have your Brussels Bulletin in front of you. Is there any questions, queries or clarifications? Rod.
Just give me one second to find it. I thought it was a wee bit ironic in the section on State of the Energy Union. It was referring to the UK's country report. It said, in addition to doubts over the UK's ability to deliver on renewables, the country report also notes modest UK support for carbon capture and storage research programmes. And obviously that's been overtaken by last week's comments, but I just kind of to flag that up. And also I was quite interested in the next section on infrastructure with the comment on the upgrade for the Scotland to Northern Ireland pipeline. So the section on, energy was quite interesting.
Anne.
Thank you, convener. Really just to highlight on page 9, I'm sure, the employment skills and education, the work-life balance. There's a consultation by the European Commission currently. I'm not sure, are we able to promote that in any shape or form or put that out on Twitter and encourage people to sign up? And also for page 10, equal opportunities, just as like you normally do, convener, just for to ensure that other, the equal opportunities in particular, catch up on what's recorded on this.
No, excellent. I think we can look at options for raising awareness of the consultation, and certainly if there's specific things in the Brussels Bulletin that we think should be brought to the attention of individual committees, you know, especially, then we do that. So I agree with your comments on the Equal Opportunities Committee. Jamie.
Yes. On page 5, at the end of the thing about economy, energy and enterprise, it says, in parallel to the TTIP negotiations, the European Commission will start work, together with other countries, on setting up a permanent international investment court. When it says with other countries, I mean, presumably it means all the EU countries. I mean, I don't... It's terribly...
Because if it's in parallel with TTIP, it could be other countries wider than Europe, so we should maybe get some more detail on that.
Well, I'd like to see a bit more detail on that, and what its actual intentions of it, what the point of it is. It's terribly... It's like the rest of this thing. It's very... it's not what it used to be.
Okay. But we can get more detail on that specific topic. Anything else in the Brussels Bulletin? Willie?
Skinner, do you remember some meetings ago, the desperate reports we had from those about the refugee crisis in Europe? And I think we asked for an update to be kept informed of how that was progressing, because often we lose sight of it once it leaves this committee. Is there any way we can get an update on the situation in the Mediterranean in particular and what's happening? Because there was quite a few desperate accounts from people around the table, do you remember? Of the circumstances that people were finding themselves in, and our hope was that the European Union itself would do more collectively to try and assist.
This committee did agree to write to a number of levels of government. We've had a response back from the Scottish Government. We've had a response back from Humza, which was emailed out last week, I think. We are still awaiting responses.
We've got
all the responses now, so what we can do is put that on the agenda as an agenda item for a follow-on meeting.
Great.
And just bring that back to the forefront.
Okay.
Yep.
Good.
Rod.
Just one other matter of kind of on migration. I've read quite a lot, mostly in tabloid papers, it has to be said, about EU discussions with Turkey. I notice there's a reference to the summit on 29th of November, but I'm not sure the next bulletin kind of clearly outlines what was actually being agreed between the EU and Turkey, rather than relying on some fairly hysterical stuff in the tabloids.
Yeah, I agree. I'm very interested in what's the progress of such of the EU's relationship with Turkey. Be very keen to hear about that. Anything else, Zella? No? No. Happy to make sure the Brussels Bulletin goes to our other committees with raising the profile specifically on the examples that we've raised, you know, the ones that Rod have raised, equal opportunities, and I would think the consultation should be the Education Committee should be made aware of that as well. Yep, happy to do that. Okay, thank you very much. And that concludes our meeting for today. And our next meeting is...
In two weeks' time on the 17th of December.
So we'll see you all then. Thank you very much. Thank you.